God bless you. You are beloved of the Lord, and we are grateful for you. We believe that in this empty sanctuary, we are more than nine, for God inhabits this place. But we also believe that in human count, we are more than nine, because by the internet and through the Spirit, many are joining together to glorify God. We pray that you will be uplifted by this service, both comforted and fortified for the challenges of these days. Please keep checking the church website for other ways to share the life of faith in the unity of the Spirit when we cannot be present in the flesh. You will find there some updates about Bible studies, book studies, musical meditation, service opportunities, to name just a few things, with more still to come. You can stay connected and informed by the church's Facebook page, Instagram page, and Twitter page as well. You can support the church in its ongoing ministries, which are considerable still, by either hitting the donate, the give button, green button at the upper right-hand corner of the webpage from which you are likely watching this at this time, or by sending in a check. If you want to designate a special gift to support our Fill the Gap program, a food donation program Monday through Tuesday for the families of the students of our after-school programs, please notify that on your check or when you give online. We are committed to steadfast prayer. I would ask as a personal favor that you would please lift up the Reverend Leanne Stroman, the pastor of the Community Presbyterian Church of San Juan Capistrano. She has COVID-19 and is presently breathing by ventilator. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Holy Week, what we call Palm Passion Sunday. In that service, we are going to be gathering at the family table of the Lord's Supper. So we would invite you that when you come to watch the video, that you would have available some bread or whatever approximates grape juice that you have at hand, that we might, in the Spirit, receive together the symbols of God's great grace. I think that's all that I need to say, except for one word of gratitude to Grant White Video Productions, by whose capabilities we are able to pull this off. We have all come from God, and we shall all return to God. And when we entrust our lives to God, God is a dwelling place for us every step between those two points. He is there to be our rock of protection and our salvation. God is, the Bible says, our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. So let us believe and not fear, as we celebrate how God is our dwelling place, and with the singers, praise God for being faithful now and forever. So be it. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God, the psalmist reminds us that you have been our help in the past, and that we can trust that you aren't going anywhere. You are on call, so to speak, to be our guide in our making decisions about how we are spending our time in light of the restrictions that have been placed upon us to preserve life, in finding creative ways to make a positive impact in the lives of others, in seeking to relate with others through the internet, the phone, and snail mail. We trust in you, O God of all ages, and put our hope in you. In Jesus' name, we offer this prayer. Amen. Please join with me in affirming our God as a ruler, guide, and stay through song.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Open our ears, O God, that we might hear your word for us this day. Open our eyes that we might have new vision to see you at work. Open our hearts that we might embrace your love for us and the sharing of your love with others. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now join in the reading of God's holy word as it can be found in Exodus chapter 25, verses 1 through 8. I invite you now to listen to this God's holy word. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to take for me an offering. From all those whose hearts prompt them to give, you shall receive the offering for me. This is the offering that you shall receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and crimson yarns, and fine linen, goat's hair, tan ram skins, fine leather, acacia wood, oil for lamps, spices for the anointing oil, and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and gems to be set in the ephod and for the breastpiece, and have them make me a sanctuary, so that I may dwell among them." Here ends this reading of God's holy word. All thanks and praise be to our Lord. Amen.
Where is God? Rabbi Menachem Mendel of Kotsk asked his followers. "Everywhere," they replied, with a correct understanding of the divine reality. "No," answered the rabbi, with a correct understanding of the human reality, "God exists where people let him in. No matter where anyone might be, God exists there for them. But sometimes God is not noticed or not wanted and kept to the outside of their life. Though God can be found anywhere, there are some settings that are more conducive to our becoming present, to God's presence, and receptive to God's overtures for friendship and relationship. A beautiful sanctuary like this can provide such a setting. But even more so, can God's people who love others as God first loved them? God's people exist to create spaces of grace in which God may be seen and recognized as worthy of pursuit. Half a century ago, one subset of God's people built this magnificent sanctuary, designing it to elevate spirits and to motivate the seeking after God. Alas, it is empty now for the time being. However, the church, which is more the people than any steeple, is still open for business. The church is a family. We, over the internet, are a family blessed by God to be a blessing to every other family. In the lovely metaphor of 1 Peter 2:5, we are a spiritual house made up of living stones, a relational space for God's grace, a community in which God is made visible and perhaps irresistible for some. In fact, there's no setting that so makes people aware of the reality of God as God-centered people who love him and everyone else. In today's scripture, God's first people are on their way to the promised land. They have received the Ten Commandments and from God other instructions. And now God asks them to take an offering from, quote, all whose hearts prompt them to give, end quote, and to collect precious stones, metals, and gems, fine yarn, linen, and leather, fragrant spices, and oils, and acacia wood. And with those materials, God asks them to, quote, make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. This, the Israelites' first sanctuary, is the fancy tent called the tabernacle, a movable construction by which the divine being and the human beings might meet. The mobility of this sanctuary symbolizes the reality of how God is not restricted to any one place, but exists in every place. And what this means is the good news that God is not remote from anyone at any time. God is there. Even if people are shivering in the loneliness of a convalescent home where their only visitors are essential medical professionals, even if they are breathing by a ventilator in a sterile hospital ward, or even if they find themselves unemployed and worried sick over feeding their family. That first sanctuary built for God's first people is the answer to the question they raised when they feared that God had led them into the desert to die from dehydration, and they cried out, "Is the Lord among us or not?" And some of us are crying out with the very same question as we stare this pandemic in all its horror straight in the eye. The sanctuary exists not for the divine being, but for human beings, especially for those who are scared and in need of assurance that far from being alone before their challenges and dangers, the Lord God is among them. The Lord for whom nothing is possible. The Lord for whom nothing is too good to do. In commanding the Israelites here, God chooses his words carefully and precisely, enumerating in considerable detail exactly what he wants for the tabernacle. He speaks, however, not in the way we may have expected. He asked them to make that sanctuary, not that he may dwell in it, but that he may dwell among them, with them, between them. In the community of caring they create by keeping his commandments to love him first of all and their neighbor as their selves. Again, God is too grand to be contained in even the grandest structure. He is, as Augustine said, like a circle whose center is everywhere, but whose circumference nowhere, no place can hold in this great God. Yet the God who exists everywhere exists in a special sense for those who are welcoming of his presence and open-handed in sharing his love. God, who the Bible says is love, and who the Bible says asks us to love others as he first loved us, dwells in the sharing of his love between human beings. It is in light of this fact that Augustine again said, "To the God who is everywhere, we draw near not by going to some place, but by loving in whatever place we are." A beautiful sanctuary can be helpful, but it is not necessary. God's people make it their business to make God visible and his love as well. Visible at least for those who are willing to open their eyes. A beautiful sanctuary can help in accomplishing that, but by our loving conduct and character, we can do that job apart from any such place. In these days where we don't have any place into which to invite others, and they have no place in which to invite us, we must, by the power of the Holy Spirit and in obedience to God's commandments to love as he loves, are to create spaces of grace where people can see God up close and personal and feel how much he cares for them. So we can get on the phone or on the computer and communicate with authentic concern and genuine caring in conversations where we listen more than we speak. And if we are reaching out to people who can't hear well on the phone and may not know how to use the computer, we can send them a handwritten note to tell them that we are praying for them and wondering whether we might come to their house and, keeping our 6 feet of distance, run an errand or two. Where does God exist? Wherever people let him. And where do people let God in? Wherever God's people love other people as God has loved them. It is not the case that with social distancing, the church cannot be itself. In these days, the church, the community, can be its best self by loving as we have been loved. Let us pray. Open our hearts to your love for us. And open our hearts to pass on your love that is not just for us, but for all. As we commit to be your sanctuary on the move, your mobile tabernacle, may your Son be the love that fills us. O Christ, immerse us and surround us with your presence, now and always. Amen. And let us all, wherever we may be, sing under the leadership of our singers the song, "O Christ, Surround Me."
Be the strength to know.
let us continue the prayer we began in song. Indeed, loving and living Christ, surround us and submerge us in your Spirit's power and grace. Make us supernatural in you, that we may show others who you are and what you can do. You bring peace, even before the fearful prospects of long quarantines, economic ruin and death, hope in the face of loss, grief, and geometrically increasing danger, and the strength to love courageously and generously when we feel overwhelmed and are tempted to despair. We acknowledge before you that we know we have a part to play in the fulfillment of your plan to bring good out of this bad thing, that we may be faithful to our task. Grant us knowledge of what you would have us do, and the energy and power to do it. Aware that others have a bigger potential for impact than ourselves, we pray for all leaders in this crisis, asking that you give them steadfast compassion, insightful wisdom, and resolute determination, and that you keep them healthy in this time of widespread illness. Give discernment to government leaders about what to do to stop the virus and stabilize the economy. Give grace to spiritual leaders to meet people's needs and to energize your people to shine with the light of love in these dark days. Give your miracle-working support to all medical leaders as they continue to put their lives on the line to care for the sick, to draw near to a cure and a vaccine, and to direct us in how to flatten the curve. Finally, help each of us to lead well in our circle of influence and to display courage, hope, generosity, kindness, and most of all, your presence among us all. You are alive and loving. Obedience to your commandment of love, we now together say the prayer that you taught all your followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And now let us enter our week, being the church, living with God and reaching out with the love of God to others, drawing ourselves into God's holy presence in the here and now. Blessings be with you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We've come this Never failed me yet. Oh.